Parental guidance is advised.
We either choose to keep on fighting or we talk.
We have our hands on the levers of state power. What can we do with this?
We always saw a black president. Always.
It was necessary. He went out the extra mile.
Now, where is that servant leadership? Well, Nelson Mandela was the epitome of our struggle for dignity, human dignity, and social justice. He went to jail when I was still a child. And for a long time, the memory of what he stood for and that generation had been erased from our memory. Our parents were too terrified to talk about politics because it was so dangerous. It could mean detention without trial, it could mean torture, it could be going to jail, going to Robben Island, or at worst, being killed. And of course, the person that most represent and symbolize that was Nelson Mandela. He became our lodestar. He became the point which represented the entire struggle over hundreds of years of our people fighting for their birthrights in the country of their birth.
There was this Release Nelson Mandela campaign driven by leaders like Aubrey Mokoena, Reverend Frank Chikane, and many others. And I think it managed to rally South Africans, one, to understand the struggles that Mandela was leading and also to understand the individual that Mandela is.
There were quite a number of white right-wing groups, you know, who were very active. There were caches of arms all over the country. There was fighting among ourselves, like between ANC and Inkatha. There were no-go areas in the country. So being the versatile, wise and shrewd leader that he was, this was possible.
Young leaders from Mamelodi like Solomon Mahlangu were brutally killed in KZN. Young leaders like Andrew Zondo were killed in Soweto, Zolile Hector Peterson. So if you go back to that history, I'll encourage young people to give themselves enough time, go online, history online, spend some few minutes, understand where we're coming from.
And I don't think people must underestimate the ravages of the war. Many black people were murdered during that period here in the country in different ways. If you put people into a homeland and you starve them to death, that's murder. If you simply take your big guns and you shoot people in the streets, that's murder. If you destabilize your neighbors where people have gone to find refuge, that is a war that you cannot undo. You fight back. So 92 years of fighting, and from 1961 Mkhonto we Sizwe formed and fighting, came to a point where we either choose to keep on fighting or we talk.
To be honest, when Mandela came out of prison, I was expecting to see a firebrand. I was expecting to see someone who is very angry and aggrieved. To my surprise, they came out of Victor Verster, this tall man with a fist up, smiling, and he adopted that attitude because many people were looking at him. When Chris Hani was killed, for instance, Nelson Mandela was given a special broadcast by the SABC and he addressed the nation. He became a statesman even before 1994.
An unforgivable crime has been committed. The calculated, cold-blooded murder of Chris Hani is not just a crime against a dearly beloved son of our soil. It is a crime against all the people of our country.
For Mr. Mandela, the most important thing was that we should get to the elections. We should vote. We should get to peace. That was the most important thing.
That excitement that we are going into power, we would change the lives of people. And I think in that was born one of our mistakes. Because like others, I thought that the state, the democratic state, should be doing everything that people needed. Building houses, finding jobs, building clinics, you know, building infrastructure. And it made people bystanders.
There was a fear that the way in which the provinces were designed would enhance tribalism, because the design of the provinces is a problem, I think. It enhances tribal hegemony. So he was a bit concerned about that, but he himself was from one of the royal houses in the Eastern Cape. So he respected traditional leaders, but not tribalism. And there's a big difference between the two.
Why is Mandela dealing with these traditional leaders who were involved with the Bantustans? You know, today somebody would just shout out he's selling out, you know. But it was important because they were our people too. They were South Africans. He didn't want anybody to be left out. He was inclusive, you know, to the extent that he would go and have tea with Mrs. Verwoerd. That's how inclusive he was.
So the combination, pain and joy, seeing that ultimately the first black president was inaugurated at the Union Buildings in 1994 on April 27. So those are the memories which come to the fore when you think about Nelson Mandela. And of course, he is the father of this South African nation.
We always saw a black president, always, you know. And I think that, you know, that was the galvanizer. We knew, because if we didn't believe in it, it would not have taken place. We believed it could happen.
When Mandela was released from prison, of course, there's an explosion of excitement, an explosion of thinking now, we have our hands on the levers of state power. What can we do with this? Because that's what we fought, to isolate the apartheid state, to weaken it, and eventually either defeat it or force it into a negotiation.
I myself had at no time entered into negotiations about the future of our country. Except to insist on a meeting between the ANC and the government.
Madiba's first speech talked about white monopoly capital. The very first speech he made on the balcony at Cape Town talked about this. The fact of and reality is our economic situation The structure of our economy is wrong.
And it was a very emotional moment, especially when the fighter jets flew ahead, you know, above the crowd with the colors of the South African flag streaming out. It was a very proud and exciting moment.
If you go back to his inaugural speech at the Union Buildings, Mandela declared publicly that never again shall anyone call the people like ourselves kafirs. Literally, he banned usages of such words, and I think that resonated with many, many South Africans who were humiliated, called kafirs, especially where we were in the Western Cape.
Never, never, and never again shall it be that this beautiful land will again experience the oppression of one by another and suffer the indignity.
I remember the day that we were at the inauguration. In the morning, we stayed over at the state guest house in Tswane. The team stayed with him. He asked to be alone to read his speech. And he sat in this room for a couple of, maybe about 45 minutes, and I watched him. And I felt, gosh, you know, we're here. We've arrived here at this point. And in my head, a lot of things were unrolling, you know, the days from the 70s, the 80s, even the early 90s, the difficulties.
It was a historic one. It was the first one, you know, that took place in the country. Okay, we were emboldened by the elections, you know, where everybody had come out, and whereas people had thought there might be violence, where everything had been peaceful, and where there was no doubt that our party was going to win, you know. We had absolute faith in our ability to serve the people of South Africa selflessly, to make things better. We were ardently convinced.
We have a very clear plan.
The ordinary man and woman in the street is watching this and is listening. They want to know if they will be recipients or whether there will be delivery of social services.
I believe that we will be able to address it through, firstly, restructuring, improving the economy if our policy is followed.
Fundamental issue of what would replace apartheid, the debate was whether whites would have, through the National Party, a veto right, or whether we would opt for a system based on one person, one vote, in a non-racial, non-sexist, democratic South Africa. And that's what we want.
We wanted the transformation of the country. I think he did too. He was very far looking. He had a great vision for South Africa. And so for him, it was about what would happen next. What were the main and most important things to do? For me, it was almost the same. I just had the anxiety that, you know, people would say, okay, we've got the vote now, so. It was never enough. The Freedom Charter was, the vote is one of the many clauses of the Freedom Charter. It's not the Freedom Charter.
So when he started in the office, the first priority, I remember if you go through the history in the presidency, when he arrived in FWT Clerk's office, there were no kettles, there were no anything in the kitchen. These guys, they removed everything. So that Nelson Mandela can sort of, I think making tea for the staff was one of the biggest challenges because their first day, there was nothing.
One of the first things that he did after the election results were announced was to meet with various different community leaders on the right wing, on the left of South Africa to assure them that they all belong to South Africa and they all have a role to play. And then, of course, we know that the government of national unity was created where the National Party and Inkatha Freedom Party were part of the first cabinet.
It is necessary for the success of the initiatives that were taken, that there should be full consultation, not only between Mr. de Klerk and myself, but between other leaders who are involved in this process, as well as the Transitional Executive Council.
Well, the most important thing was to make sure that we dealt with the legacy of apartheid, basic services that people needed. We developed a program called the 100-day program, where we sort of guaranteed free healthcare to pregnant mothers and children under five. You know, primary education would be compulsory and free. We would start a number of infrastructure projects that would look at how do we rebuild the infrastructure where our people lived.
There were impetuses that were already in place. So for Madiba, it was finding the right people who would be able to carry the weight of the manifesto that we had put in front of the country.
So a lot of it was around transformation. How do we transform the state into a state that could deliver to all citizens, irrespective of their color? And that itself was a tremendously huge challenge, because we had inherited a state that was basically bankrupt. 93 cents in every, you know, every rand was already allocated to expenditure that was, we couldn't change.
The cabinet had to meet urgently and take a decision to amalgamate all the Bantustans into the Republic of South Africa, undo all the various education departments in different, what was then called the Bantustan education departments, into one. Amalgamate all the healthcare systems into one. You also didn't have, for example, the Cape Administration Department of Education. It was one, a national education department.
So I guess the first cabinet meeting would have had some tension, but I think genuinely everyone in that cabinet would have been interested in working towards a democratic South Africa.
With the government of unity, it was there. It was necessary for continuity.
Madiba is a lawyer, so for him it was really settling down very correctly every element of how the government, the machine, had to run. And he was the CEO of the country, so that was his thought.
The challenge of that first 5 years was a tremendous challenge against great odds to create stability. At the same time, we're sitting in a cabinet with the Inkatha Freedom Party and the National Party, who were our sworn enemies in the course of fighting our struggle. So how do we learn to work with each other, to understand each other? At the same time, within the ANC, there were different strands that came together, people that had come from exile, people that had come off the Robben Island, people that were the older generation, there were people that were part of the mass democratic struggle. And we all had to learn to work with each other and to find a focus where we can concentrate on the work to be done at so many different levels. It was tough. His first speech when he comes out of prison in 1990 is, "I stand before you as a humble servant who have been freed because of your struggles." Now, where is that servant leadership? And that's what we seek today. And that's what I hope the next generation represents, going back to those principles and values of volunteerism, of heroism, of service, of solidarity, and taking us away from this path of greed, of corruption, of state capture, to a point where I look at the human connection between you and me, I look at the human connection between me and the environment, and the forests, and the streams, and you know, the mountains, the animals, and I see that there's a connection. That is the essence of who Mandela is.
And of course, he had extensive meetings with the National Party of the time. And what was the result of that was the Government of National Unity that you saw in the first administration.
And everybody made a contribution to that. And Mandela's aim was to get all those contributed. Not to say this one is more important than this. This is, but to get everybody, the churches, labor, you know, NGOs, everybody to be involved in as much as that had been the case in the international support against apartheid.
This is a moment of enormous significance in the history of our country. Through the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, we can now deal with our past.
Well, the Reconciliation Project was a really important project, and one must never look at it in a negative way. Because literally, if one sat in 1994, particularly around the murder of Chris Hani.
It was obvious to us that the late Chris Hani, as the leader of the Communist Party, was the real threat to our future and that of the Republic of South Africa.
The Hoflayer says, don't commit crimes. Is that right?
Mr. Chairman, then you must describe a crime. When is a crime a crime? When you're involved with a freedom struggle, is a crime a crime? When
murder,
you're involved in a wartime situation.
Murder is a crime, Mr. Darby Lewis.
But then, Mr. Chairman, then you must refuse to accept the ANC's crimes as well, because they also murdered.
We were a fragile state. In fact, most of the people in the world felt that it was inevitable that there would be a racial civil war in this country. And the country felt like it.
Take your guns, your knives, and your pandas, and throw them into the sea.
It was necessary. He went out the extra mile. That was fantastic. And that's what a leadership. In fact, it was required. It was required that people come together. Yeah. There's no way out. That you've got to give it to the man. He played a very important part. Yeah. That was reconciliation.
If you're familiar with Soweto, you'll know that there were areas designated for Zulus, areas designated for Tshivendas, areas designated for Abatswana. So post-apartheid, you know, such structures naturally collapsed and socially people were integrated. So those are some of the achievements if you look back 25 years into democracy. There was no truth and reconciliation economically. There was no move to support the political process. And as a result, most business people disinvested in the South African economy.
Madiba's greatest wish was for a united nation that would not have sexism and racism, which is also the National Democratic Revolution's idea of for the country, which is the ANC's idea. It's hard work, and I think he had the energy to do that. He had not just the energy, but the skill. And it does take a skill.
Mandela's mission and Mandela's objective was to deliver us political freedom, like that of Steve Biko or many of the heroes and heroines in our past.
The sad part about the Truth and Reconciliation Commission was that those who were behind the perpetrators of apartheid killings were not charged. Guys like Eugene de Klerk and many others, the foot soldiers, were the ones who were ultimately sentenced. The big bosses did not make presentations, and those who were operational were the ones who became victims.
I would quote Tamin Tintin. Tamin Tintin was a friend of mine. He was very angry with this whole thing, Truth and Reconciliation. You see, because, I mean, with all the suffering, you're personalizing the thing that were individuals. So those individuals have been done, so everything solved. The suffering of South Africans, there is a list. I mean to say that all South Africans, they've got a relative who was killed simply because it was done by people in power. So basically, it is a joke, you know. Yeah, it's a joke.
There were powerful symbols that Madiba used to make everybody realize that they are part of a common South Africa. And one of those was that famous rugby match that happened in 1995 at Ellis Park. Madiba realized very early on that he needed to make those powerful statements, so he attended the match and he wore the rugby jersey. And of course, South Africa dramatically won the match in the last minute of the game.
Black people celebrated the win in 1996 in the World Cup, Rugby World Cup, as much as white South Africans. I went to my first rugby match that day. You know, the reality is that symbols are powerful in bringing us together. And you know, it's like a glue that holds together. So I think the national anthem was that. We had to find a way that everyone felt part of the new nation we are building.
But when Mandela wore that shirt of the South African Rugby Union, it appealed to us as those who grew up in the rural areas playing rugby, and who could identify with players like Francois many of those players during that time. But I think that symbolism, it really created an atmosphere where sports became a unifier.
South Africa had gone to an impasse. And in that impasse, there was no way that that impasse would change. Again, the liberation movements were very weak. They pretend to be very strong, they were very weak. But the mere fact that they came and agreed to a point saying they're going to solve their problems through political means, that is very important.
Madiba was very, very clear. He said, look, Nkosi Sikelel' Afrika is our national anthem. But there is the stem, and that was the national anthem of the apartheid regime. What can we do symbolically to unite people is by patronage. Let's put it together.
That national anthem, this time, is a reminder of those days. And it's a reminder of those people with their mentality. That thing has got to change. They should get a new anthem that's going to talk about the new South Africa.
I remember when I first started working in 1994 in the Parliament of South Africa, in the administration in the Western Cape, it was a bit difficult to work with my white colleagues, but because of Nelson Mandela, it was easy for me to employ certain gestures taken from Nelson Mandela. And as a result of that, we managed to build those relations. Non-racialism was given meaning by Mandela's conduct, his public posture.
For the first time, the blacks were extended civil rights and civil liberties. That's all that we got. We were extended civil rights and civil liberties. These are the fights of black Americans, not of us, only in this land here.
Mandela was a very versatile figure. He was also an accessible person. He was also not a know-all, you know. He relied on the people he worked with, not only the people he worked with. He relied on expertise from the people he worked with as well as talented people in South Africa to assist us and all over the world to assist us to move forward.
And he was a remarkable man to work with. He had an extremely high work ethic. Very dedicated to the task ahead of him, focused on what must be done every day, didn't believe the day was over until everything he planned to do for that day had actually been achieved, even if it was a phone call or a letter or a discussion that he had to have. So we had a good, I would say it was a close working relationship with him, and it was a good one.
The RDP is about transformation. It is not about reform. It's not about slipping back into our old practices. It's about evaluating every cent that we spend and every position in government.
It is a broad framework for development and reconstruction. Housing is just one small part of it. But of course, the RDP was much broader than just RDP houses. It was about basically everything we wanted to do, from how we restructure sports and culture to how we restructure education, health, trade and industries. It was a massive program for restructuring of the economy.
RDP stands for Reconstruction and Development, and it was a portfolio. There was a minister responsible for RDP in Madiba's office.
But then the biggest thing is that how are they going to be financed? South Africa basically is trying to run a welfare state when its economy is very small. There are countries in Europe which are running welfare states, yeah, but the economy is very big. The South African economy is not big, it's not robust enough for it to actually maintain these gears, and that's where our problem is.
We went back to our people in the universities, in the factories, in the rural areas, in the urban townships, in every space we had these conversations. What is it we want to replace apartheid with? And it crystallized into a set of demands around basic rights, of course, basic infrastructure, the right to housing, the right to water, right to electricity, right to quality education and quality health. And of course, all weaved into a constitution that we wanted, that at the heart of which stood the fight for social justice and addressing the legacy of apartheid. Black economic empowerment was never created in order to make just a few people very rich in our community. It was about widespread transformation. In fact, when the Reconstruction Development Program started off, there were many conversations about empowerment in the factory floor. And it morphed into something else, which became about economic empowerment. And black economic empowerment became about how to create the type of transactions where individuals were able to acquire stakes in big companies.
The Black Empowerment Project, BEE, that was one of his ideas, was that you cannot assume that white capital will simply make room for black people to become economically active. You had to give impetus to that.
The BEE policy basically is theft. There's nothing about that BEE. It's legalized theft, that's all. In all those assets, not even common assets, that were sold. Now I'm talking about assets of ISCO, assets of Vodacom. When those assets were sold, the companies continued. But then under the BEE charter, those companies had to get BEE partners, and the BEE partners, it is themselves. Yeah. The political elites.
They say 85 people, individuals in the world, own more wealth than 3.5 billion human beings. That cannot be justice. That system is sick. That system is terminal. That system is destroying this priceless heritage that we have that has been given to us. The air we breathe, the water that we drink, the plants that grow, we've been given this as gifts. and we abuse it to satisfy our own material needs. Now that's something completely contrary to what Nelson Mandela stood for.
Over the last few years, especially when the Fees Must Fall campaign was at its height, Madiba's legacy has come under a lot of scrutiny and attack, especially amongst young, angry students and the youth, basically. We don't ignore it because I think that it's silly. Madiba was very much into confronting issues and discussing them and not hiding and shirking. So that's what we try to do, to live up to that ideal of speaking to people who disagree with his legacy.
What has 94 given people? Right to come and associate with whoever, to marry a white woman or marry a black woman. But all that nonsense, you know, and say that is freedom. That's an insult to black mind.
If there was any mistake, it was not Mandela's mistake. It must have been a mistake of the ANC. But the documentation would then be able to show why I'm saying certain decisions were not taken, which present generations think were a mistake.
It's a question of understanding how history shapes you and how history will shape the youth. Our youth have an opportunity now to become magnificent future leaders of South Africa and Africa. But the anger and the cynicism and the WhatsApps and the Twitters and the superficial conversation that they're having is not helpful.
More than 10,000 graduates every year on average. We have over 14 million people on the unemployed list. But the problem now is it's the job market open for us as young people.
Do young people today have a reason to be angry? Absolutely. If I was young today, I would have a deep anger because I would feel that on the issue of the fundamental objectives of transformation, we have not made tremendous progress. Although there has been progress in many other things.
The generation after us, I think in 1990, that's when things were beginning to change, so they can't relate with the past laws, they can't relate with apartheid education. For instance, in our schools, we were taught biology in isiXhosa, everything. And now when you have to write your English paper, you struggle.
It's very difficult to explain, especially to young people, what freedom means, you know, because it's something that you can touch. People cannot touch. People associate with, cars or houses or clinics or hospitals or schools, you know, and they measure, you know, our success as a society in terms of those things only.
History is history. You can't change that. And if you want to change something, you don't change it by insulting people. You always change it by working together with others who can also assist you in your path towards the place you want to be at. And I think that was Madiba's legacy, is don't break a thread.
Mandela administration basically is this, that people were very innocent. Huh? People were innocent, at least, inverted commas. People were so sort of innocent, you know, people had not shown their claws.
The beauty about the Nelson Mandela administration is that it had selfless leaders. Nelson Mandela was not concerned about his family. His administration was not captured by forces like Guptas. Today's leaders, it's about themselves and their families. If you look at the Agritsi, the Bosasa saga, it exposed the kind of leaders that we have. he are a member of cabinet with all the benefits. He are still getting brown envelopes from Agritzi, Christmas packs, cases of brandy, 200 kilograms of beef. And you look at that and arrangement, you say, but really, these guys, they don't even care about their own neighbors. It's them and their families.
You know, when we worked with Mr. Mandela to the last minute, I don't know what happened when he went to Pretoria. We would, every day at lunchtime, we would collect money from everybody in the office to go and buy lunch. And he would make us so angry because he had a little purse which he would take out, and he would take out these pennies and sixpences and, you know, six and count them till they came to whatever. And, you know, we'd say, okay, Tata, will he say, no, this is money.
That personality is irreplaceable. The kind of person that is never unkind, but can be firm. And will fight for the things he wants with clarity and honesty and stand his ground. That was his worth. He never caved in.
You know, Mandela once said to me, you know, what about the reconstruction and development of the soul? And I thought, now what is he talking about? And he says, you know, we've been so deeply wounded because of slavery, of colonization, of apartheid, that we all need to heal. So whether you have a malaligned feeling of being superior or a malaligned feeling of feeling inferior, you're both wounded.
And I think it's thanks to Nelson Mandela, Walter Sisulu, Oliver Tambo, and all those great men. And it's thanks to the younger men who worked with them. You know, the Mbeki, Thabo Mbekis, the Trevor Manuels, who understood, you know. It's thanks to the movement, you know, the UDF, you know, and all the other organizations that fought here in South Africa and kept the people conscientized about what was going on. The youth, you know, women, everybody.
He played his part because the change was very peaceful. Yeah, I'm not an angry person, I'm just sort of critical, very critical of issues.
By the time Madiba stepped down as president of the country, he was already in his 70s, late 70s. And the fact that he needed an office to help carry on the work that he was interested in tells us that he never really retired. You know, he continued playing an active public role right up until 2004, when he made a statement here that he wants to now retire from retirement. But even then, he limited his activities, but he would still come in occasionally to meet with people, and he still took an interest in what was happening out there in the world.
I'd like to simply look back one day and be able to say we've achieved some of what we set out to do. And I'll keep working until I can't anymore for those ideals. Non-racialism, non-sexism, unity in the country, an economy that works for everybody, and that we will have a woman president in this country one day. I will work for that. I don't have any personal ambition beyond where I am now, except to work for the people of South Africa, and that's it.
When he really stood down from public life in 2004, the Board of Trustees of the Nelson Mandela Foundation refocused the work of the foundation from his post-presidential office to a legacy institution promoting his values and his legacy.
The disjuncture between my generation and that younger generation is we're not talking about the same things. But if we start to listen more to younger people rather than judging them, rather than saying to them, you don't know what it means to fight for freedom, that's arrogance. We didn't fight for freedom to boast about it. We fought for freedom because it was the right thing to do. And so what we need is a more honest dialogue, an honest conversation about our challenges, about what we need to do to work together to build that better life we promised our people in 1994. And in that, a core partner is the younger generation.
To remind us who we are, who we were, and how we must find those values again that will make it possible for us to improve the quality of all our people.
I think firmness, stay focused. Don't waver on your beliefs. Don't be influenced by the South Africa's media rhetoric and agenda. Walk away from it. Read it, say it's there. Stay with your beliefs. Tackle the economy. Be firm on education. Make sure that we have a healthy country. Have a belief that everybody has equal rights and nobody's rights must ever be trampled on. And the rule of law must always be topmost in our minds as people. Human rights for everybody. There's no such thing as variations in human rights. There can't be human rights that differ from one another. A human right is a human right. And I think that that was his cardinal policy perspectives, that human rights are equal in every way possible. You can't have human rights based on class or culture or race or creed. A human right is simply that, a human right.